Jenny Sanford is the author of the new memoir, Staying True. There you see its cover. The book has just been published. Did you think of putting the title Getting Even?
No, I'm not trying to get even, really.
Why'd you write it?
You know, I feel like I struck a chord with a number of folks around the country who were surprised maybe that I didn't crumble, and I'm just hopeful that I can help some other women.
Do you see it also as some sort of retribution or some sort of catharsis?
Catharsis, yes. Retribution, no. I'm not really interested in getting retribution. I think it's an honest account of what the values that I hold dear and the things that I turn to in times of crisis or in a busy political life to keep myself very solid and grounded in my faith, my values. You know, I look to my faith, I look to my God, I look to my friends, and I look to my relationships with my family.
Was it hard to write?
It was hard, but it was also, as you said, you know, cleansing. It was cathartic.
You have four children, right? Three
yes.
teenagers?
Yes.
And one 11-year-old.
Yes.
Did you talk to them when you were about writing it?
I did talk to them about writing the book. They had some mixed blessings, but they basically were all in favor. Yeah.
They read it.
They haven't read it yet. But, you know, I'm not so sure. It's not really a children's book.
I would say.
I've read to them parts of it just to make sure they were okay with it. And my hope is in time when they're ready, each of them at their own time will read it. And I hope they'll learn in time and when they're ready the things that mean a lot to me and what got me to this decision.
Isn't it difficult, Jenny, if I call you Jenny?
Yes, please do.
Isn't it difficult to talk about pain?
You know, it's very difficult to talk about pain. It's very difficult to talk about things that are very, very personal. You know, I've always considered myself very private, but I didn't make this public. As a matter of fact, if you read the book, you'll see that I spent a good long time trying to keep it very private and from becoming the spectacle, in fact, that it became.
Yeah, you did. In fact, you knew about it. A lot longer
months.
Than we thought you knew.
Right,
about it.
Right. And I did everything I could to kind of keep it private and to protect the family. But once it became public, I just figured, you know, there's so many women out there that have connected with me and said that they either admire the fact that I stood up and stood up without losing a sense of who I was. And so I hope that if I can even help a couple of women out there, it'll be worthwhile for me.
Let's go back. You first met, you were a career woman on Wall Street, right?
Right.
What was the attraction?
You know, I had been here in New York for, you know, from 1984 through 1990. I met Mark in 1987. He was, to me, kind of a breath of fresh air. I'm a solid Midwestern type of a girl, and I found him refreshing. I found him honest. I found him just kind of a breath of fresh air.
He also didn't have much experience in the dating game.
No, he really didn't, and I found that also refreshing. But it brought with it some different challenges. You know, a couple of things he would say weren't, you know, what the normal suave guy that's been around the block a couple of times
like.
Would say. Like right before we were getting married, when he said, you know, there's... Your priest gives you a menu of different vows, and he says, well, you know, I, with all due respect, I'd rather not use a vow that uses the word faithful in it. And I said, well, you got to be kidding me. And but after that, you know, we had a very honest, frank conversation. And
why did he want that out?
He just said, you know, I have this kind of, I took it as just an honest assessment of, you know, the things he was nervous about. You know, marriage is, everybody has doubts before they marry, because marriage is a commitment for life if you take it seriously. And he just said, I don't know. I don't know if I can stay, with one
true.
Person for to stay true. Yeah.
Didn't that throw you?
Well, it did throw me. But then I said, you know, we had a serious conversation. I said, marriage is much more than the word spoken in a vow. Marriage is a commitment to one person. I mean, that's what it is. It is a vow of fidelity. And we thought, you know, we spoke about it. I said, are you saying you don't want to get married? Because to me, marriage is a vow of fidelity.
Yeah.
And he was, no, I want to get married. No, you're the one. He was fully committed. So I took it, you know, at the end of the conversation, and we revisited the conversation a number of times. I was absolutely certain. And there's no question, I had my own doubts about Mark, but fidelity was the last thing I was worried about. I was worried about other things.
Did you ever think, Jenny, if we're talking about Catholic guilt sometime, mm-hmm. was it something I did?
You know, the thought goes through your mind and you start soul searching and, you know, how could I have known, you know, what could I have done differently? But at the end of the day, no, I really have not dwelled on that. In some respects, I really, when I look back over our lives, I see the stress and strain that came with the political world we were in. And I see a number of different factors that maybe, you know, coincided in his life at one time to just make him, maybe lose sight of who he really was. And that was saddening to me. You know, it saddened me. It didn't make me angry.
Now, even after he admits the affair, it's one of the shocking points in this incredible book. He asks your permission to go visit her again. You write that at one point he requests to see his lover. They were frantic about seeing her.
Mm-hmm. Near the end,
needed
before
permission.
Near the end, before he actually went to Argentina, he kept asking for permission. He had to see her. He said something in his heart, and he had to figure it out. I'd never seen him like this ever in my life. And he was talking about love in different ways, about he just was lost, frankly. And there was nothing I could do to wake him up.
Did you accept the fact, hey, he's in love with this woman?
Well, what was funny is he didn't just, I would have accepted it if he said, I'm in love with this woman and this is what it is. But it was like he didn't know. He had to see her to find out.
But he wanted you to stay.
But he wanted me to stay. He didn't want to give up what he had. And that, to me, was painful.
And that's called chutzpah. Mm-hmm. Gall, right? Mm-hmm.
But he said it in a way that was he was almost oblivious to the pain he was causing.
Did you believe he was hiking the Appalachian Trail?
I had my doubts, but I was hopeful he was hiking the Appalachian Trail.
Didn't you worry about missing?
Well, I had kicked him out of the house. I had asked him to leave. He was begging to see his mistress, and it was ripping me up. So I said, you need to leave. So I was hoping that by starving him of contact with the family for 30 days, he would wake up to what he might lose. So I said, please have no contact with the boys or I. And I asked him to tell the boys that he was going to be gone and he'd have no contact with us. They didn't understand it, but he was gone. For the first week, I knew from people in his office he was in Colombia, but we weren't speaking. And then the second week is when he disappeared, and he told everybody in his office he was hiking the Appalachian Trail. So the only information I had was through people in his office. I had my doubts, but I was hoping that's where he was.
And then he admits it. Let's watch that now famous clip from June 24th, where he publicly admits having an affair. Watch.
Mm-hmm. The bottom line is this. I've been unfaithful to my wife. I developed a relationship with what started as a dear, dear friend from Argentina. It began very innocently, as I suspect many of these things do, in just a casual email back and forth, in advice on one's life there and advice here. But here, recently, over this last year, it developed into something much more than that.
You watch that?
Mm-hmm. It's not something you ever want to watch on national television.
Well, a lot of wives in those situations appear with their husbands.
Right.
Usually a little, they stand back a little and they sort of look sad. Did you think of going to that press conference?
No, never crossed my mind.
Did he ask you to go?
No.
How do you think he handled himself?
From a personal standpoint, as a wife, not very well, and from a political standpoint, not very well.